championship? And can Scott Johnson beat out Vidmar for the all-around title and lead Nebraska to their fifth consecutive NCAA title?
The Special Event Center on the campus of the University of Utah is the site for the 1983 NCAA Women's Gymnastics Championships. The host school, the University of Utah, is the two-time defending champion, and they're looking for an unprecedented third straight title. But this year, Utah can expect a very strong challenge from Arizona State. The Sun Devils are seeded number one coming into the tournament because they have produced the best scores in the country.
This CBS Sports Special, the NCAA Championships, is sponsored by Allstate. For home, auto, business, health, and life, you're in good hands with Allstate. Monroe Shock Absorbers, makers of the Monroe Gasmatic. And by Rust-Oleum, for rust-fighting products that let you do it fast and make it last.
We're at Recreation Hall at University Park, Pennsylvania, on the campus of Penn State University, where the Nittany Lions host the 41st NCAA Men's Gymnastics Championships. Hello, everybody. I'm Irv Cross. I'll be calling the play-by-play on this championship meet, and my expert commentator is Peter Corman, the only American to win a medal in the Olympic Games in 50 years, and he secured a bronze medal in Montreal in 1976, and currently as coach of the gymnastics team at the Naval Academy. Peter, what's your assessment of this competition here?
Well, Irv, the championship this year is in three categories. We have the team, the all-around, and the individual event finals. In the team competition, Nebraska is trying to make history in winning its fifth straight consecutive NCAA team title. But they expect strong competition from UCLA and Penn State as well. In the all-around competition, defending champion Peter Vidmar is here trying to win his second title. But Scott Johnson has already beaten Peter twice this season, so it's not going to be easy for Vidmar. And in the individual event finals, what we're really going to be seeing is the top eight performers from the entire nation on each event. That's some of the best gymnastics in the world.
Some of the best indeed. The coaches here have been telling us that the field here is so talented that we could very well see the best championship level of competition we've seen in many, many years. Let's go to Salt Lake City in the women's competition.
From the University of Utah Special Events Center in Salt Lake City, it's the 1983 NCAA Women's Gymnastics Championship, and the largest crowd ever to witness this collegiate event is on hand, a crowd of 8,000, to see if the University of Utah can win a third straight unprecedented women's gymnastics title. Hi, I'm Charlie Neal, and working with me, Kathy Johnson, a three-time World Team Championship member and Olympic gymnast. And Kathy, can the University of Utah do it?
Well, it's going to be a tough job. On paper, Arizona State is favored to win this competition, but the Utes have the home crowd behind them, so I think it's going to be a very close competition.
Okay, we're going to see how the University of Utah does. Meanwhile, let's take you to Penn State, the site of the men's championship in gymnastics, right after this.
For one team, and they seek another national championship right here at Recreation Hall as they seek a gymnastics title before a warm and receptive home crowd. In the men's all-around competition, it's a two-day competition. Peter Vidmar from UCLA is the defending champion, closely followed in second place by Scott Johnson. And the reason why he's second is right here. The standings after the first day of compulsory exercises. Vidmar, Johnson, Regal, and Babcock. And Scott Johnson from Nebraska is now getting ready in the optional exercises in the pommel horse.
Scotty looked a little tight in the compulsory round of competition, and now he's starting out on the pommel horse. Most all-around performers would not prefer to perform first on the pommel horse because it's very nerve-wracking and easy to make a mistake on when you're nervous. Scotty working very well here. Oh, no, there's a bad mistake. He was going into the scissors. He hit his leg on the horse and stopped. That's a critical deduction.
Why is the pommel horse so difficult, Peter?
Well, you just saw a good example of that, Irv. Where his nerves got to him, he's a little nervous starting the competition. He didn't lift his leg high enough to get into the scissor, and that cost him a lot of tense points. That's too bad for Scott Johnson.
We'll see how much it costs him. Scott Johnson, the pommel horse, coming up with a score of 9-1 for a total score of 66.95. Remember now, you add the compulsory standings plus the optional score for the all-around championship. And here's Peter Vidmar, the all-around champion, getting ready on the vault.
Peter is defending all-around champion in the NCAA championships last year. A much improved event for Peter. He's added a twist to the vault, making it more difficult. Watch the flight. One step, but a very good landing.
One step and a good landing for Peter Bidmar. Now, you'll hear a lot of activity as these athletes compete. Here's Peter Bidmar on the replay, on the vault, false step. And we'll get his score in a second. But there are six events going on simultaneously. So you'll hear people reacting as the athletes perform. And Peter Bidmar comes up with a 9-7 in the vault for a total of 68.3. So at the end of the first round of rotations in the all-around competition, Peter Bidmar continues to lead. Scott Johnson now is in fourth place. Scott Johnson is preparing his mount now on the rings.
Scotty does a new ring routine this year, very difficult. Watch this strength part at the beginning of his exercise. He raises his body backwards and lands in the cross position. Now pulling against gravity lifts back to the L. That's a superior strength part on the rings, which is why Scott Johnson excels on this event.
Peter, there's a little bit of movement there in the rings. Is there some tolerance for movement on the steel rings?
Well, the judges allow the gymnast to move slightly like that. They don't want excessive swing, however. Scott is very free in his swinging motions. He goes back and forward to a handstand without bending his arms. That's virtuosity. Now watch this dismount. A double twisting, double somersault. Perfect landing. That was a beautiful routine by Scott Johnson.
Boy, did he ever really nail that. Perfect routine, nearly perfect routine by Scott Johnson. We'll just see how perfect it is when the score comes up. But here's the replay on the dismount.
Scotty's doing a double twisting, double somersault. Learned this from his teammate Jimmy Hartung. Two twists, two flips. Excellent.
Outstanding performance by Scott Johnson. He'll pick up the score of 9-9 on the steel rings for a total of 76.85 in the all-around competition. Peter Bidmar from UCLA now prepares for the parallel bars.
Peter's looked so solid this competition thus far. A very good event for Peter. Oh, no, there's a mistake. He should have went directly to a handstand, but you could see his body pike. That's going to cost him some points. Working now on one parallel bar rail. This is a part of originality which receives extra points in gymnastics, as well as virtuosity and risk. Recovered from that mistake very well, Irv, and that's not easy to do.
Peter Bidmar, the defending all-around champion, coming here to this competition today on the parallel bars, a score of 9-4 for a total running score of 77.7. At the end of the second round of competition, an all-around competition, Peter Bidmar leads, and Scott Johnson now is closing the gap.
This is a strong event for Scotty. He could pick up some points here. He's a very good vaulter. He's doing a Sukahara, full twist in the laid out position. Nice vault by Scott Johnson.
Scott Johnson, trying to make up for that error on the pommel horse, comes up with a real nifty vault and a score of 9.85 for a total running score of 86.7. Peter Bidmar will be up soon. Right now, getting ready for the high bar.
A very good event for Peter. He's last year won the NCAA championships on the high bar and scored a 9.9. Peter's one of the best performers in the world on this event as he captured third place in the World Cup championship last year.
Keep in mind again all the noise and distractions we're hearing during this competition. Other athletes are performing at other stations. Will that break your concentration, Peter?
It can, but not to the experienced performer. Nice front semi catch by Peter. This routine looks super. He's working very well. A new dismount this year for Peter on the horizontal bar. He does a double salto in the laid out position. This is a high risk element and is awarded extra points. Perfect landing.
What a beautiful dismount. Peter Bidmar, the defending all-around champion, coming up with an outstanding dismount. We'll see a replay here on the catch.
Here's his front semi catch. He loses sight of the bar, sees it on the same side, grabs perfect.
Peter Bidmar, waiting for his score, seems to be happy with that performance. And there it is, 9-9 on the horizontal bar for a total running score of 87.6. At the end of three rotations in the all-around competition, Bidmar continues to lead. Scott Johnson now is in second place. In the all-around competition, Peter Bidmar has a slight lead over Scott Johnson from Nebraska, and Scott Johnson now is preparing to go to work on the high bar. Is this a good event for Scott Johnson, Peter?
Well, traditionally, this has been one of Scotty's weaker events, but in the last year, he's beefed up his routine by adding a lot of difficulty. You'll see some of those difficult maneuvers are done on one arm. Here's one right here. Full giant swing, turns to the eagle grip. Extremely difficult. Now watch this. A one-arm giant swing right to a release move, combining two risk elements.
Would you say the high bar is the most dangerous event in men's gymnastics?
I'd say so, and here's one reason now. A triple flyaway, three complete rotations, beautiful routine by Scotty Johnson.
Scott Johnson from Nebraska coming up with an exciting high bar routine, knowing full well he has to really turn on the gas here to overtake Peter Vidmar in the all-around competition. Here's the replay.
Here Scotty's completing a triple somersault. There's still only a few performers in the world that do this. Three rotations to a nice landing.
Nice landing indeed, and Scott Johnson earns a score of 9-9 on the horizontal bar for a total running score of 106.25. Peter Vidmar, the defending champion, now gets ready to work on the pommel horse.
We've seen a lot of 9.9s thus far, and it really doesn't occur that much in gymnastics. It's just that what we're seeing is the best performers in the country on every event. So those 9.9s happen very seldom. It's just that we're seeing the top routines.
Peter Vidmar is a defending champion. Peter, does he have any weaknesses at all, or is he just strong on all the events?
Well, he's a very good all-around man, and what I mean by that, he is very strong on every event. He has no weaknesses. He used to have a few form breaks on this event, but he's cleaned that up. Walking backwards there at the end of his routine and right to a handstand, incredible exercise.
An unbelievable exercise by Peter Vidmar. There's his father indicating his pleasure at that particular routine. And we'll pick up a replay on Peter Vidmar on the pommel horse.
Now watch this. As Peter starts his dismount sequence, he's actually going to move backwards down the horse. This is extremely difficult because he can't even see where he's putting his hands. Very risky, especially to do it at the end of a routine when you may be a little tired.
Peter Vidmar, an exciting pommel horse routine, comes up with a score of 9.95. 9.95 for Peter Vidmar for a total running score of 107.25. So at the end of five rotations in the men's all-around competition, Peter Vidmar continues to hold a slight margin over Scott Johnson from Nebraska. Vidmar now preparing to mount the rings.
Scott Johnson received a 9.7 in that round of competition on the floor exercise. That means Peter only needs a 9.1 to capture his second all-around title. 9.1. Should be an easy job for him on this event.
Would he go into a fairly conservative routine to make sure he gets that 9-1?
Well, Peter has a dismount on the rings that he's had trouble with all year. It's a double-twisting, double-somersault, the same one Scott Johnson did. Let's see if he chooses to leave it out and play it safe. Go for broke and throw the hard dismount. Here it comes now. Let's see what he's going to do. He did the hard one. He went for the double-double, and he nailed it. Excellent routine by Pete Vidmar.
What a competitor. He had an option of either taking the easy way out or doing a more difficult dismount, and Peter Vidmar elected to go the tough route because he is truly a champion. Here's the replay.
He just had trouble with this dismount all season. He's put his hands down in a number of competitions. Two somersaults, two twists, gets it in. Nice routine.
Nice routine for Peter Vidmar. And he winds up with a score. See it in a second. 9.7 on the rings for Peter Vidmar for a total running score of 116.95. And that will be another NCAA all-around crown for Peter Vidmar. And Peter Corman, our champion, talked to Peter Vidmar about his second consecutive title.
Peter, congratulations. An excellent day. 9-9 on high bar and a 9.95 on pommel horse. You must be happy with that.
Yeah, I really am. I'm really psyched with it. The meet went. I trained really hard for this. I had a lot of meets in the past 2 months. And so I was wondering if I'd be able to be up for the meet, and everything went well, so I'm really happy.
Congratulations to Peter Bidmar for retaining his second all-around championship. We'll be back later, but right now, let's go to Salt Lake City after these words from your local stations.
Nestled in the foothills of the snow-capped Wasatch Range of the Rocky Mountains, you're looking at the Special Events Center of the University of Utah, site of the 1983 NCAA Women's Gymnastics Championships. Hello again, everyone. I'm Charlie Neal, and I have the pleasure of working with three-time World Championship team member and Olympic gymnast Kathy Johnson. And Kathy, what type of meet can we expect to see?
We'll see the top five collegiate teams and the top five individual all-around gymnasts. In the team competition, Utah is trying for their third consecutive team title, which has never been done before. Arizona State, however, on paper, is expected to win this competition, but Utah has the home crowd advantage.
When you look at the individuals, who do we look out for?
Well, there's Elfie Schlegel. She's an Olympic gymnast from Canada, and she has totaled the highest all-around total this year. And then there's Megan McCunniff of Utah. Here again, she'll have her home crowd behind her, and she has been consistent all year long, so it's going to be a tough individual competition.
Okay, let's explain how this competition works. Now, we'll be watching the top five seated teams and individuals. As in every women's gymnastics meet, there are four events: the vault, the uneven parallel bars, the balance beam, and the floor exercise. Each team will compete on each apparatus. So instead of the usual four rotations, we will have five rotations, with each team sitting out one rotation. The first rotation has been completed. So here are the team standings. The defending champions, Utah, are in first place. But the favorites, Arizona State, have not yet competed because the Sun Devils drew a bye in the first round. And in the individual competition, Utah's girls also lead the pack, followed by a four-way tie for fourth place with Canadian Olympian Elfie Schlegel from the University of Florida, fifth. The second rotation is now underway. Arizona State is on the vault. This is their first chance in the second rotation. They did not compete in the first. And the roar you hear in the background of the crowd, as you know, there are four different events going on at this time. Lisa Zeiss is the young lady you're looking at now. Her first vault score, an 8.9, as she gets ready for her second vault.
She's doing a layout Sukihara. She must show a full stretch of the body on the afterflight. And she doesn't quite do it. We'll take another look at this vault. She has a good run into the horse. She comes onto the horse fine, but right here she stays piked and doesn't quite reach the laid out position.
Lisa Zeiss, the freshman from Cheektowaga, New York, a world championship team member to Moscow in 81, and you see her score, a 9.1. And now from the defending champion, Utah, Lisa Mitzel, currently in first place in the all-arounds after one event. And before this competition, we got a chance to spend some time with Lisa.
I can't stand just sitting in my, you know, room. You know, the dorms are so small, and, you know, I always have to be moving around or doing something. I can't study for very long. I'm not very good at that.
Lisa Mitzel calls herself an impatient, stubborn perfectionist. Those characteristics are no doubt a big reason why Lisa is one of the bright young gymnasts here in Utah in a program which ranks as one of the best in the country. A better than average student, Mitzel excels in Spanish.
¿Por qué están contentos los chicos, Lisa?
Los chicos están contentos porque tenemos un jardín grande donde pueden jugar.
Lisa grew up in Anaheim, California, where she competed as an elite gymnast. Leaving a regimented club atmosphere and close family situation, she found her new freedom at college sometimes hard to handle.
I think I'm, you know, learning and dealing with it a lot better, you know. I gotta think more about studying instead of having fun.
Lisa's become involved in weight training. She says it has made a big difference in her overall strength. She competed as an elite gymnast in high school, but now with a demanding college academic schedule and new social life, she has no real plans for the 1984 Olympic team.
All that training is just too intense, and I think I'm doing really well in college right now, and I'd like to stay there.
Well, she's doing very well in this competition so far. She's currently in first place in the all-around after one event, and now she's getting ready for the floor exercise. Lisa Mitzel, one of the school's top all-around competitors. She's a freshman. And Kathy, what are the judges looking for in the floor exercise?
Well, basically, the tumbling and the dance, and the way that they flow from their dance into the tumbling. The tumbling should be strong and dynamic. They need to show height off the floor, several twists, and sometimes even somersaults. The dance must be pleasing. There we just saw a triple turn on floor. You don't see many of those. It's a difficult dance combination. Here's her first tumbling run and a double twist. Very nicely done. You see several of those in the competition. What you're looking for is height off the floor and a good, crisp, clean twist. Listen to that audience in the background. They really get into the music. Utah has done an excellent job of selecting their music. It has great audience appeal.
And the fact that they're performing before the hometown crowd doesn't hurt. And this crowd here, they turn out for gymnastics in Salt Lake City like no other place in the country. In fact, they're one of the few schools that make money on gymnastics.
That's right, and they make it a fun event both for the gymnasts and for the audience. Lisa has an excellent routine going on here. She's meeting all the requirements in dance and tumbling. Now she can just finish up with a good, strong tumbling run. She'll have a good exercise.
Lisa Mitchell from Utah.
And a full twist. Very nice. Good, solid exercise. It's a good way to start off Utah. This is her first tumbling run. This is the double twist. She gets nice height up on the floor. Doesn't quite finish the twist soon enough. Still very nice.
And we'll wait for her score. She was currently in first place going into the event. She picks up a 9.2 for a total of 18.75. Lisa Mitchell in the floor exercise. This is her teammate, Megan McCunniff. She is currently trailing Lisa Mitchell. She's in second place. And this young lady, a junior, a communications major from Cedar Falls, Iowa, co-captain of the Utah team with Linda Cardos as she prepares for her floor exercise. Want to remind you once again, this is the second rotation. Each team is performing on a different apparatus. This is Utah on the floor.
The nice thing about floor exercise is the ability to express yourself in different ways. And Megan shows a softness and a beauty in her floor exercise that you'll see different than some of the others. She has a little bit different style. And beautiful feet. She has such exactness in every step that she takes. Has a beautiful toe point and very sure on her feet. The judges really look for that. Middle pass, handspring front, through to a fall. Nice middle pass.
Routine and the Utah crowd here loves it at the Special Event Center in Salt Lake City. Megan McCunniff, the co-captain, and we'll look at her routine once again.
We're seeing her second tumbling pass again. It's a handspring front. Look at the rise up off the floor. And right through to a round-off full twist. Megan has a lot of power, and yet she's got a lot of grace as well.
And a lot of experience from this young lady from the University of Utah. As you see her score, a 9.45 for a total of 18.60. She's still in second place. This is Jerry Cameron from Arizona State. Again, want to remind you, Arizona State drew a first round bye. This is their first chance at competition. And the score for Jerry Cameron on her first vault, a 9.45 as she gets ready for her second vault.
I'm amazed at the strength and power of this gymnast. She has tremendous run, handspring front, good landing. Very nice fall.
John Spini, her coach, and we'll look at her vault once again. From Arizona State, Jerry Cameron.
This is what makes Jerry's vault so good. Look at the height of off the horse. Good clean tuck and a nice landing.
Jerry recorded a 9.45 on her first vault. She picks up a 9.5 here. She'll take the highest score of the two vaults, which gives her a total of 9.5.
So looking at the individual standings, after two rotations, you find the University of Utah occupying the top two positions. Arizona State, the favorite coming in, not among the leaders. The reason, they have only competed in one rotation. At the team standings, the University of Utah, the defending champion, in first. Arizona State is in fourth place, while Florida, which did not compete in the second rotation because of a bye, is in fifth. Get ready for rotation number three. Utah will sit out this rotation. They received a bye. This gives Arizona State a chance to move up. I'm Charlie Neal along with Kathy Johnson. And Kathy, Arizona State can make their move on Utah right now.
That's right. Both teams have come well prepared, and now it's all up to who's going to put it together.
And Jerry Cameron, representing Arizona State, has a chance to move Arizona State closer to that top spot.
In uneven bars, we're looking for major swing elements, such as clear hip to handstands, toe onto handstands, giant swings. We look for releases and catches. Here's one release to a handstand. And this is another release, front somersault to the high bar. So prepare for a dismount with a clear hip to handstand and a toe on front dismount. Nice routine.
And her team loves it. Look at her teammates from Arizona State. They're fired up because they know they have a chance to close the gap between their team and Utah.
That was a clear up to handstand preparing for a dismount. Toe on front. Jerry is a strong gymnast and she did an excellent routine.
Jerry Cameron, the senior from Arizona State, a 9.35, which gives her a total of 18.85. Now we're looking at Elfie Schlegel from the University of Florida, her first vault.
Elfie will perform a layout sukihara. A sukihara is a half twist on the horse and a back somersault off. Little leg separation and one step back. Nice vault.
Elfie Schlegel, a member of the 1980 Canadian Olympic team, and she's from the old school, especially when it comes to discipline.
It is a demanding sport, and it takes up a lot of time, but I feel that that effort is worthwhile. It certainly has paid off in a lot of ways for me.
And one of the ways gymnastics paid off for Elfie was in a scholarship to the University of Florida. You know, she liked the idea of palm trees and sunshine, and she can even cope with those occasional monsoon seasons. But the primary reason that Schlegel came to Florida was this lady, Florida coach Ernestine Weaver.
Well, there's a little bit of a Canadian connection there. I was formerly a Canadian citizen, and when I would go home, people would say, oh, Ernie, wait till you see this little gymnast that we've got now. She reminds us so much of you. And I'd say, oh, I want to see this little gymnast. And then I'd go home to visit my parents, and I would see in the local recreation centers pictures of this little Elfie Schlegel, a gymnast. We tried to recruit her, and we got her.
Florida got Elfie, but Elfie missed out on a chance for a medal in the Moscow Olympics. Now her sights are set on Los Angeles.
84 is just around the corner, and certainly has been in my mind to try again for the 1984 Olympic team. I would have really liked to have gone to Moscow in 80. It would have been the first Olympics, and I know for a lot of other people it was a big disappointment. I'm just, you know, looking forward to the future and to 84, and hopefully things, if things run smoothly, I'll be there.
Things have been running smoothly for her today. Her first vault score, a 9.2, as she gets ready for her second vault.
She's doing a more difficult second vault, a sukihara with a full twist. She needs to better that score to stay in contention, but I don't know if she's going to do it with that low landing.
A 9-1, not as good as the first score. She'll take the first vault score, a 9-2. This is the balance beam with Penny Hochschild of the University of Alabama. The balance beam, 4 feet high, 4 inches wide, one of the most demanding of women's gymnastics.
Of all the events, this event requires the most concentration. It requires a strong sense of center, strong ankles and knees, so that you can move fluidly throughout the entire routine. It requires aerial moves, dance elements, and acrobatic and flexibility moves.
Penny Hochschild, the University of Alabama, finished second behind Elfie Schlegel of Florida in the South Regionals that led up to this competition.
Very slight balance break. That was a more difficult series. Consecutive back handsprings. A balance break like that could cost anywhere from 2 to 3 tenths. That was her aerial movement and aerial cartwheel. The aerial moves are the more difficult moves on the balance beam. The judges are looking for steadiness and sureness as she works over the beam. Also looking at the feet. The toes must be pointed and strong. Dismount, cartwheel with a full twist. Very good landing. She has to be happy with that. There's nothing like the feeling of hitting your beam routine.
Penny Hauschau from the University of Alabama. The Crimson Tide coming into the competition seat at number 5. And there's the score for Penny, an 8.95 that gives her a total of 27.45. So now we'll look at the individual standings after 3 rotations. Penny Hauschau is in first place, but she has competed in all 3 rotations, as have all of our leaders right now. Julie Goe from Cal State Fullerton and Tanya Rogers also from Cal State Fullerton. As you look at the team leaders, Alabama and Cal State Fullerton, both with 3 events behind them, lead. Utah drew the bye this rotation, so the bottom 3 teams have competed in only 2 events. University of Utah, over 8,000 fans on hand for this year's event. This is Lisa Mitzel from the host school, Utah. We've seen her score for the first vault, a 9.05, as she gets ready for her second vault.
Lisa does a layout Sukahara. Here again, we'll look for a strong run, good pre-flight, and high stretched after flight. A little low on the landing. I think she was a little bit slow in her run, lost speed on the boards, therefore going over the horse slow. Right here, she needed to increase her speed, snap down into the layout, which she didn't do.
9.05 for her first vault score. We'll wait to see what she came up with on this second vault. A 9.1, and that gives her a total of 27.85. Lisa Mitzel. This is Jerry Cameron from Arizona State as she gets ready for the balance beam.
That was a cartwheel mount onto the beam. We haven't seen that much in this competition. That handspring. This is where experience helps.
We have to remind our viewers that there are 4 events taking place at this same time, so there's a lot of distractions. There's a floor exercise going on to our right. That's the music that you hear. There's also the vault and the uneven parallel bars.
Jerry's moving so well, I don't think she has any idea that anything else is going on in that gym. She's been strong throughout the entire competition, and she's moving strong right now on beam. Interesting combination. Valdez. That's a more acrobatic movement, which I said earlier was a requirement for balance beam. And an aerial cartwheel. Slight balance break. That should only cost her a tenth, though. Look at the smile. That's nice to see on beam.
Especially a beam that's 4 feet high and 4 inches wide.
That's right. So many gymnasts tend to be too cautious on beam, and you can't compete cautiously. She's working aggressive, pairing dismount, cartwheel full twist. Very nice exercise.
Jerry Cameron, the senior from Arizona State. She's a very happy young lady. She thinks she's done very well.
She certainly has. She knows it's going to keep her right up there in contention. Aerial cartwheel. This was the only slight balance break she had in the entire routine.
There's a score, a 9.2, that gives her a total of 28.05. Jerry Cameron from Arizona State. You're looking at the University of Utah and Megan McCunniff, the junior communications major, who is the co-captain of the Utah team and fiancé to coach Greg Marsden. And we got a chance to spend some time with her before the competition.
Megan's a late bloomer. She was a solid but unspectacular performer in her first 3 years at Utah, finishing second last year in the beam at the NCAA championships. This year, Megan is consistently ranked near the top. One reason she is still improving is that she still enjoys the sport.
You know, I'm still very motivated in gymnastics, but I don't do cartwheels back into the tumbling line and things like I did when I was 6 and 7, so I think that's changed a little bit, but I haven't had lots of injuries or problems like that, so for me, it's really, I feel as young as ever.
Although Megan has a low-key personality, she certainly maintains a hyper schedule. In addition to 4 hours of training each day, she also runs and teaches aerobic dancing. Megan is a motivated student who will get her degree in public relations this spring. There's also another big day on McCunniff's calendar.
In June, she will be married to her coach, Greg Marsden. That might have raised a few eyebrows, but they handled the situation quite well.
Well, Megan and I talked about it quite a bit before we decided actually to go out, because we knew that there were it affected a lot of people other than just ourselves. And we knew that we are, to some degree, in the public eye, and we have some responsibilities along those lines. So we tried to handle it appropriately by going home to her home, talking with her parents about it, getting their permission, then coming back, talking to our athletic director here, letting them know what was going to go on up front, and then talking with the girls on the team and make sure that they understood and were as comfortable as possible with the circumstances.
Megan says she still gets yelled at just as much as the other girls.
And we're about to see her first ball. She shouldn't get yelled at today, huh? Everything's on the line.
All right, she's having a good competition so far. She'll be doing a handspring front. Oh, no. Gosh, that isn't at all what she planned. Something must have gone wrong, either on the run or off the board. She knew she didn't have it, so she just aborted the ball.
Well, we'll look at it once again. Maybe you can pick out what exactly went wrong. Megan McCunniff.
I believe it probably happened right here. She had a good run. She just realized right then that she wasn't in the right position or didn't have the right speed. So she's got another shot at it. Last shot. This is for the team and for the individual.
And she's smiling. And with the low score of an 8.15 for a first vault, she gets ready for number two.
Well, now the pressure's on. She doesn't have another vault after this. Up. Oh, nice ball. Oh, I know she's relieved.
And the team loves it. The crowd loves it. 8,000 on hand at the Special Event Center on the campus of the University of Utah. Megan McCunniff will look at her second vault once again.
Here she's got a good, strong run. She's up. Good position off the horse. Nice height. Opens up for a good landing.
Remember, her first vault score, an 8.15. She has to do much better this time. There it is, a 9.5. And the music you hear in the background is for our current leader, Penny Hochschild. She's on the floor exercise. Let's go to her.
Penny's had a good meet so far. She's made every event. This is her last event. She really needs a good, strong score here to keep herself up in the all-around. A little bit more extension. She needs bigger movements and to really work on her feet. They're not quite pointed all the time. Here's her change of pace. She's shown fast dance and slow. Now she's preparing for her last tumbling run. She's got to be strong. And a full twist. A good landing. She really just needs to extend herself more. And a good meet for Penny.
Penny Hochschild from the University of Alabama. She'll be our leader. She's completed four rotations. The question, Kathy, is can she continue to be the leader?
It's going to be tough. She lacked some difficulty in this exercise, and the polish just wasn't there. And there's the score, a 9-0. It's not going to be high enough to keep her up in the lead.
She's the only one to complete four rotations. The battle lines are drawn. Here's Megan McCunniff. She needs an 8.40 to lead, and she'll be battling this young lady, Jerry Cameron from Arizona State, who needs an 8.45 to take over the lead. So here are the standings in the individual competition after four rotations. Penny Hochschild from the University of Alabama is in the lead, and that's her final score. Megan McCunniff and Jerry Cameron will battle it out for that number one spot. Now looking at the team standings, Alabama has completed four events. That is their final score. They are finished for the day, as you see the standings for the top five spots. Are sensing a third straight unprecedented title for the Utes as they go after Arizona State, who is the favorite coming into this competition. Looking at the team standings after four rotations, Alabama, which has completed all of their rotations, their final score is in, but it's come down to a battle between Utah and Arizona State. This young lady, Megan McCunniff, needs only an 8.40 to take over the lead as she gets ready to work on the bars.
She should be able to do it. Nice mount. That's a half turn to a handstand on the low bar. Megan swings very, very well. She's got excellent form. Swing very well, keeping dismount. Toe on front, dismount. Good landing. Didn't have a lot of difficulty in that routine, but she gave away no tenths in form deductions.
And we'll look at her performance once again. Megan McCunniff.
Megan doesn't have the big skills that some of the other gymnasts have. She has good handstands, though, but the best part about her routine is her form. She doesn't give away anything in form deductions. Preparing for a dismount, a toe on front. Look at the height of the dismount.
And Kathy, listen to the crowd here at the Special Event Center on the campus of the University of Utah as they see the score, our new leader, Megan McCunniff, in front of the hometown fans. And they love every moment of it.
Megan should be very pleased with this competition. She's done a great job.
And here's Jerry Cameron from Arizona State. You see what she needs to win, a 9.45. And she's preparing for the floor exercise.
It's going to be a tough score to get, but she's very strong in this event. She's a powerful tumbler, and her dance is very good, too.
Well, let's watch. Jerry Cameron from Arizona State. And you can see Megan McCunniff looking on, knowing that she's battling this young lady for the lead.
The excitement in the competition is really great right here. Preparing for her first tumbling run, which is a 1.5 twist. Step out through to a double twist. Very difficult combination. She broke form a little bit, but it shouldn't cost her too much. A lot of energy in this floor routine. Middle pass, lay out half, through to a full twist. Jerry's doing a wonderful job, and Megan knows it. It's very close between these two. Jerry's getting ready for her final tumbling pass. She tests in strong, and then it's up to the judges. She looks very sure of herself. Here's the last pass. And a round off full twist. A little weak for her last tumbling pass. A nice exercise. A lot of energy. She just really put out for this exercise.
Jerry Cameron, Arizona State. As you said, Kathy, she used a lot of energy, and it shows. She needs a 9.45 to take over the lead.
It's really going to be close. It's up to the judges now. So middle pass. Jerry's such a strong tumbler. She really gets up off that floor. That's going to count in her favor in the judges' eyes.
And we'll have to wait for the judges' decision. She needs a 9.45 to take over the lead. Here's the score. Disappointing 9.3 after a great performance by this senior, Jerry Cameron. She has worked so hard for 4 years and come so close. Kathy Johnson on the floor. And look at Megan McCunniff.
The 1983 NCAA all-around gymnastic champion, the University of Utah's Megan McCunniff.
And the crowd of 8,000 says it all.
I feel great. Surprised, I guess, because I was so involved with the team, I guess I didn't really think about it. I can't believe it.
That's what was so great to see. You are such a good team member, and the team was so fired up, and you really kept them going. I saw after beam, after the fall, I really felt for you there, but you came back and fought like a tiger.
Didn't matter. It didn't matter. I had to help everybody else get through.
Well, congratulations again.
Thank
you. Super
job.
Again, congratulations to Megan McCunniff. We'll be back to look at the final team standings after this word from your local station. Jerry Cameron of Arizona State was second. The final team standings finds Utah winning an unprecedented third straight title. And our Kathy Johnson is with Coach Greg Marsden.
Greg, how does it feel? You weren't expected to win this third one in a row.
Well, this is the best, because just because of that. The last 2 years, if we hadn't have won, it would have been a big disappointment. This year, we had nothing to lose and everything to gain. And we really, I don't think, on paper, we're the talented, most talented team on the floor. But the kids worked hard all season, and I think we really worked to our potential.
The hard work has paid off, and it showed. And the thing that was really great was the spirit that they showed. It was great. It was great.
This is Megan McCunniff. We take another look at her, the 1983 all-around champion. She has led the University of Utah to an unprecedented third straight title in women's gymnastics. Now we're going to take you to Penn State, where the University of Nebraska will try for a fifth straight title in men's gymnastics. We're at Recreation Hall, University Park, Pennsylvania. I'm Irv Cross, along with Peter Corman. And we're now getting ready for the men's team championship. And, of course, Nebraska is going for its fifth consecutive title. Never been done before, Peter. How do you assess the field?
Well, the field has been super this year. It's been narrowed from the top 10 teams in the nation down to three. Nebraska, UCLA, and Penn State. Nebraska won fairly easily last year, but they've already been beaten twice this season in dual meet competitions. And one of the teams to do that, UCLA. We've seen Peter Vidmore so much this year. He's a tremendous athlete. He could possibly lead that team to take that fifth consecutive title away from Nebraska. But you cannot rule out Penn State. Penn State did it this year in football. They feel they can do it in gymnastics.
Penn State is highly optimistic coming into this competition, and one reason is right there. Bill Stanley on the pommel horse scoring a 9-9 in that exercise, causing Penn State to get into the final three. They finished real strong, edging out Iowa State and Ohio State to make that final three for the team championship run. Scott Johnson from Nebraska represents his team on the floor exercises.
This has always been a very strong event for Nebraska floor exercise, but they've lost two good performers in Jimmy Hartung and Steve Elliott. Scotty's added a lot of difficulty, a nice double back layout somersault. He actually has the most difficult routine on floor exercise of any all-around performer in our country.
Looks very strong and very confident going through this routine, Peter.
He certainly is. This has been a strong event for Scott, even when he's a young boy. As a strong event for Nebraska, it's nice to be able to start out on one of your better events. It's not going to be easy for Nebraska this year, however. They've had some injuries. They've been beaten this season by Iowa State once and by UCLA. So they know that if they are not consistent, if they don't go through and hit all their routines, they could get bumped off.
Of course, all the routines includes all five members of the team scoring well on the team competition. There's Scott Johnson finishing his dismount on the floor exercises. It looked awfully good, and the Cornhusker fans love it.
They've drove all the way from Nebraska to Penn State in a bus to watch the Nebraska team try for its fifth consecutive title. Unprecedented. A 9.85 for Scott Johnson. Very nice floor routine. What a way to start out.
Peter Vidmar is preparing to perform on the pommel horse exercise, and we asked him prior to the exercise what's more important to him, the all-around championship or the team title.
I'd give anything for our team to win, more than anything. I don't care if I place 10th all around. Of course, I'm going to have to do my best to try to get the team to win, but we really want that first place award, and this is my last year that we can do it, so we're really going all out for it.
One of Peter's stronger events, the pommel horse. He's defending champion on this event, capable of scoring a 9.8 and above.
He's been competing an awful lot, though, Peter, with the all-around title and now the team title. He must be feeling some exhaustion now, some fatigue, wouldn't you think?
Well, it's very tough for an all-around performer to be in a competition like this because of the all-around, the team, and the individual event finals. But Peter's been trained for it. Beautiful exercise. Boy, he looks as good as he's ever looked.
Peter Vidmar on the pommel horse. UCLA scoring a 9.8 for the UCLA Bruins. Ken Viscardi from Penn State now represents his club on the still rings.
Ken's a junior this year at Penn State, but he had to sit out last year because he had surgery done on his knee. He tore a cruciate ligament, a very serious injury, and he's actually competing with the brace on under his pants. He's an all-around man. He's been unable to do floor exercise and vault that effectively this year, but he's very good on the rings. He's extremely strong. He's got that brace on and must have that in the back of his mind when he comes to dismounts.
Peter, would that be sort of a psychological barrier, you think? Do you think that knowing full well he's going to come down a full force on that weak knee, that it might, he might hesitate on the dismount?
Well, I certainly think it's in his mind, and he's cautious of it when he lands, not to make his knee go out. Here he is, winding up for the dismount. Let's watch the landing now. Nice job. Little stiff-legged on the right leg where the brace is, but a very fine exercise.
Ken Viscardi from Penn State demonstrating a great deal of courage, coming down on that weak knee, scoring 9.65 in the still rings for the Penn State Nittany Lions. And, of course, there's a standing after the first rotation, Nebraska, Penn State, and UCLA. Coach Carl Shire from the Penn State Nittany Lions looks on, a former Olympian and Olympic coach in 1976. Looks on as Terry Bartlett from Penn State gets ready on the floor exercises.
Terry's a gymnast from Britain who learned gymnastics on the junior level in the United States, but he's a British citizen and will be representing Britain in the World University Games this summer in Edmonton, Canada, which you'll be able to see on CBS.
Long, lean lines. Again, Bartlett is fairly tall for a gymnast, isn't he?
Yes, he is, and he handles his body very well. He's had a problem with that in the past in that he hasn't been strong enough physically, but he's improved on that in the last year. A lot of good gymnastics comes out of Pennsylvania. That's where Terry learned his junior gymnastics when he moved here from England. Nice double back dismount, one step, but a fine exercise for Terry Bartlett.
Terry Bartlett trying to get his Penn State Nittany Lions into the hunt for the team championship. Comes up with a score of 9.5 in the floor exercises. Phil Cahoy from Nebraska is getting ready on the pommel horse. We asked him which of the events he worries about most during the competition.
Well, like every gymnast, it has to be the pommel horse. That's the scariest of all events for a person to miss. It's real easy to miss. And if a team goes through that event without any misses, they're one step up on a lot of other teams.
A true statement for Nebraska. Pommel horse is one that all gymnasts worry about. Earlier in this same round of competition, Nebraska had some mistakes on the pommel horse and lost a little bit of the lead they had built up. So they really expect a good routine from Phil to make up for those lost points.
Peter, it's sort of surprising to hear a competitor like Phil say that, though, because he's been in a top-ranked gymnast for years and been in world competition. But the pommel horse concerns him.
Well, it certainly does. You know, it's that type of event where there's no stops. There's no place to gather your composure if you're a little off. You just have to keep going. Boy, that was a super exercise for Phil. He's ready. His team's going strong.
Tremendous concentration by Phil Cahoy as he went through that pommel horse exercise, knowing full well in the back of his mind that perhaps this is one of the events he fears most. Here's the replay.
On the still ring.
Phil's long body is very advantageous on the pommel horse as it gives him a unique look, a look that most all-around gymnasts do not have because they don't have the height that Phil has.
Phil Cahoy from Nebraska picking up a score of 9.8 on the pommel horse. Alex Schwartz from UCLA now gets ready on the still rings. He's a powerful-looking young man.
He sure is, and Alex is a specialist, meaning that he only does one event in gymnastics. He only works the rings. And boy, does he ever work the rings. He spends 4 or 5 hours a day practicing this one routine. After perfection.
Are specialists allowed to compete in the Olympic Games?
No, they're not. The Olympic Games are only for all-around performers. They must compete on 6 events for international competition. In the United States, at the collegiate level, we do allow specialists to compete. And for that reason, a gymnast like Alex could do very well in the Olympic Games if he were allowed to compete. A super routine here. Looks right on the money. Preparing now for a dismount, a double somersault in the laid out position, looking for solid landing. Beautiful exercise. JUCLA is right on track.
Look at the expression of relief on his face when both feet came solidly down on the mat, and he knew darn well he had a good routine in the bag. Alex Schwartz just beamed. Here's the replay.
Here's another look at that double layout somersault. Spots the ground, plants his feet, and nails the landing.
Is he pleased with that performance? Alex Schwartz from UCLA picks up a 9-9 on the steel rings. So after the second round of competition in the team competition, Nebraska leads by a score of 94.75. UCLA and Penn State trail. Penn State coach Carl Shire about the role of the specialist.
Well, the two men that we have on pommel horse are specialists. They just do that event. Their names are Bill Stanley and Tom Ladman. And they certainly are wonders to work with. It's a pleasure as a coach, as you know, to work with that kind of level talent. It's they do things so original, no one else has done. So difficult, many R moves, wrist moves, double R moves, and both of them are extremely virtuous in what they do too. So they get the extra points that make that routine up into the 10 level. And those two specialists are kind of tough. I'm not so sure that any other team has that 1-2 punch at the end of the pommel horse like we do.
There's the number one of the 1-2 punch, Tom Ladman from Penn State, ready to complete his mount on the pommel horse.
Tom's had a tremendous season. Consistently scores from a 9-7 to a 9-9.
Peter, I guess he's so good, he has his own move called the Ladman move. What is that?
Well, that's a skill that he invented, a very original part, coming up right here. Right there, he turns his hands in a funny position. Very nice routine. That's going to get a great score.
Tom Ladman from Penn State, one of the specialists that Coach Shire was talking about, who he feels is one of the top pommel horse men in the country, scores a 9-9. What an outstanding performance. Tom Ladman, obviously a favorite here at Penn State. Almost perfect. Peter Vidmar from UCLA on the floor exercises.
Nice full twist and double back somersault for Peter. That trick has given him problems this year, but he nailed that one solid.
Now, Peter, we ought to keep in mind that the scoring Nebraska still leads this team competition, but Nebraska, UCLA, and Penn State are all closely bunched. And right now, the team title is up for grabs.
Penn State competing on their best event in this round, the pommel horse, could score higher than UCLA's team on floor exercise, so we could have a very interesting change of events after this round of competition.
Peter Vidmar looks so graceful, but yet still very strong.
He is strong, Irvin. He has traditionally not been that good on floor exercise. He's improved this event. Watch this dismount now, a double pike salto, very difficult. Nice exercise, Pete Vidmar.
Oh boy, look at the determination on his face. Do you think they want this team title? He did tell us that the team championship would mean more to them than the all-around title, and he scored a 9-8 on the floor exercises. Scott Johnson is the next man up on the rings for Nebraska.
Nebraska's always had a tremendous ring team. Last year, led by Jimmy Hartung. Scotty's kind of stepped into Jimmy's shoes on the rings. He does a similar routine with the same dismount, very difficult dismount. Lifting to his mount. Locked arms, rising right to the cross.
You know, Peter, when you watch Scott Johnson perform, you can just see the intensity and the concentration as he goes to work at each event. Now, here on the rings, well into his routine here.
That's right, and he's concentrating very hard on this team championship. It means a lot to Nebraska to win for the fifth straight time an NCAA championship. Never been done before. Scotty wants that real bad. Nice routine, a solid exercise. Nebraska's on its way.
Todd Johnson on the rings for Nebraska. Of course, there it is. There's a score at 9.8 for Scott Johnson on the rings. An outstanding performance. Here's Bill Stanley, the other specialist that Coach Shire at Penn State talked about, ready to perform for the Nittany Lions.
And Bill Stanley is just awesome on the pommel horse. Watch the extension and lift he gets off the apparatus. That's virtuosity and very risky elements as he walks from one length of the horse to the other, turning in the flare. Well, that Penn State pommel horse team is just incredible. One of the best in the world, certainly. Nice routine going here. Needs a solid dismount. Lifts it up. Excellent exercise.
Oh, boy. Coach Shire and the whole Penn State team and everybody in this auditorium practically on their feet realizing that Bill Stanley has come up with an outstanding performance. Bill Stanley from Penn State on the pommel horse, one of the top specialists in the country. There's a replay.
And here he's doing a flaring motion. Now watch, he turns on one pommel, make it extremely difficult, and breaking into his scissors. Very nice. And now picking up the double leg circle work again. Preparing for that dismount that goes to a handstand. Watch the lift, watch the extension. Beautiful.
Outstanding performance. Beautiful indeed on the pommel horse. Bill Stanley was only perfect. A 10.
And Bill's gotten a number of 9.9s and 9.95s this year, but he's never gotten a 10. That's his first 10. What a moment for Penn State Gymnastics.
UCLA and Penn State, but that team title is really up for grabs. And Chris Rigo from Nebraska is preparing for the vault, the young man from Reading, Pennsylvania, so he's right at home here at Penn State.
Yes, he is, and Nebraska has an awesome vaulting team. They had a very high team score coming in. Beautiful vault by the freshman, stuck it cold.
Chris Rigo, a freshman at Nebraska, showing excellent form.
Chris is the youngest gymnast in America to win a USA Championships, and he did it on this event with a vault very much like that one. Perfect flight, perfect landing.
Perfect flight, perfect landing, and an outstanding score with a 9.9. Tim Daggett from UCLA mounts parallel bars.
Parallel bars right now is a rough event to be on. Nebraska's lead is slim, but they're on their strongest event, the vault. So what UCLA needs now on this event is solid routines, no mistakes at all.
Do you think Daggett and the UCLA team are really conscious of what they have to do here now, that he knows he really has to hit because Regal had an outstanding vault? There he goes on his dismount.
I think he knows it because he just hit a great routine. That's as fine a parallel bar routine as I've ever seen Timmy Daggett do.
Timmy Daggett, nicknamed by his teammates the Bull. What a competitor. Has he ever determined? Parallel bar score, 9.8. Keeps UCLA well in the team hunt. Penn State has Terry Bartlett on the horizontal bar.
Terry's an exquisite performer on the horizontal bar. Very difficult exercise this year, with a lot of skills done on one arm. Here's the first one. Now back to one arm again. Very risky. He's after those extra points awarded to risk. And another one arm skill. Now looking for a solid dismount. Nice landing. Beautiful exercise. Risk, originality, everything's in there.
Boy, is he ever happy. Terry Bartlett.
And let's take another look at that dismount, a full twisting double somersault. Penn State really is in the move now. They really look great.
Great indeed, and Bartlett comes up with a 9.8 on the horizontal bar. And Penn State now, after four rotations, has moved into second place over UCLA. Standing job to give them a commanding lead. Penn State and UCLA are fighting it out for second and third place. And Phil Cahoy from Nebraska is ready to mount the parallel bar.
Phil is a two-time NCAA champion on this event, 1980 and 1981. So this is a fine event for him, as it is for Nebraska. Watch the lift he gets off the parallel bars. Right there. Boy, this Nebraska team really looks great right now, Irv. They have the rhythm. They went right through vaulting. Nice routine there. They're going to be tough to beat.
You can just feel the momentum building with that Nebraska team as they go from event to event. Phil Cahoy coming off the parallel bars with an outstanding... There's his father. Looks just like him, doesn't he?
His dad coached him in high school, too, so he's really been close to Phil's career.
There it is. 9.85 on the parallel bars for Phil Cahoy. And Tim Daggett from UCLA gets ready to mount the horizontal bar.
The best word to describe Timmy Daggett on the high bar is aggressiveness. He attacks the apparatus. UCLA has had some early misses on the high bar in this round of rotation. They need a top score right now to stay in the championship, and they've asked Timmy Daggett to go out and get it.
Peter, have you ever seen a gymnast more determined than Tim Daggett?
Well, there's a lot of determined gymnasts, but I don't think I've ever seen anyone more determined than Daggett. Now, watch this dismount. Full twisting double fly in the laid out position. Beautiful exercise.
Tim Daggett trying to get his UCLA Bruins back into the championship race for the team title because they've really struggled as a team on the high bar.
They had some early misses, but let's take another look at that dismount. Nice lift, nice somersault, beautiful landing.
And for Tim Daggett's efforts, he comes up with a score of 9.9 on the horizontal bar. Steve Friedman from Penn State is getting ready now to perform on the vault.
Steve's a tremendous vaulter. Watch the height and distance he has away from the horse. Penn State's finest vaulter. Very nice, but a little over somersault. Had to take a big hop there. That's going to cost them the needed tenths.
Steve Friedman awaiting the judge's decision, and here's the replay.
Nice somersault action. Held the pike a little too long and had to step forward.
A little false step there for Steve Friedman on the dismount. And the judges ruled he earned a 9.7 on the vault. So at the end of five rotations, Nebraska has a commanding lead in the team championship. Lead over second place Penn State and UCLA, who was in third right now, are really nip and tuck.
They certainly are. What a battle it's been between Penn State and UCLA. Peter Vidmar leading off for UCLA on vaulting. Peter's a much improved vaulter over the last year. Has added difficulty on this event. They're trying to get second place back now. Nice vault, that's going to help them.
Peter Vidmar, determined to get his team into second place, scores a 9.8 on the vault. Bobby Payton from Penn State gets ready now on the parallel bars.
And from the first day of this competition, all the teams have known that consistency was going to be the key. Penn State cannot afford any mistakes now if they're going to maintain second place, because UCLA is a very good vaulting team. Bobby Payton looked real good right now. Oh, there's a bad form breaker. He's off balance. He's off the bars. He's gone.
Oh, what a shame.
That's a severe deduction. The deduction includes the fall itself plus all the form breaks that occurred before it. And that could kill the lead that Penn State had over UCLA.
I guess all Bobby can do now is go back and regain his composure of what he's done and start over again.
And at this level of competition, you make a mistake like that, it really pulls your team score down. Too bad for Penn State.
Penn State with about a two-point lead over UCLA going into this round of the competition. And Bobby Payton, only coming up with an 8.6 on the parallel bars, finds that lead eroding. Scott Johnson from Nebraska now gets ready to attack the high bar.
I think at this point in the competition, Nebraska can taste it. They know that they're about to win their fifth consecutive NCAA title. No team has ever done that in the history of collegiate gymnastics. They deserve a lot of credit. What a tremendous program they have at Nebraska. They replace a Jimmy Hartung and a Steve Elliott, come back the next year with an even better team. This turning out to be one of Scott Johnson's better events and one of Nebraska's best events. They have a tremendous high bar team. Watch this dismount now. Triple flyaway, three somersaults. One, two, three.
Oh, what a routine. Scott Johnson on the high bar. And you can feel that momentum building with the Nebraska Cornhuskers as they smell another championship. Their fifth consecutive NCAA gymnastics title. There's Jimmy Hartung, the former great Nebraskan, who's now a graduate assistant on the coaching staff. Here's a replay.
And a beautiful one-arm release skill to a perfect Delchev. And that Nebraska contingent is happy they drove all the way from Nebraska to Penn State in a bus to watch the Cornhuskers go for number five. And now the triple flyaway to cap off the routine. Excellent.
An outstanding performance by Scott Johnson. That just about puts the lid on it for the Nebraska Cornhuskers with a 9.9 on the high bar. Bobby Campbell from UCLA is preparing his vault.
And UCLA can move up into second place now, but they need a solid performance right here. He had trouble on the high bar. Can he make up for it? A perfect vault. That was an excellent vault. Tremendous flight, and he stuck the landing cold.
Bobby Campbell coming up with an outstanding vault for the Bruins. Here's the replay.
Watch the lift he gets off the horse with perfect form. Opens up, and it's right there.
Perfect form indeed, Peter, because Robbie Campbell has scored a 10, a perfect score on the vault. Of course, that puts an awful lot of pressure now on the Penn State team because Penn State and UCLA are fighting out for second place, and Terry Bartlett from Penn State now is getting ready on the parallel bars.
And Terry needs a 9.75 to have his team, Penn State, tie UCLA for second place. A 9.8 would give them sole possession of second place. A tough chore.
You talk about pressure. This team competition coming down to the very last rotation.
A nice routine, but he lacked a little extension and originality. It's going to be tough for him to get that top score with that routine.
Terry Bartlett needed a 9.75. He scored a 9.55 on the parallel bars. So it looks as though Penn State may well slip down into third place. Phil Cahoy from Nebraska is getting ready now to go to work on the high bar.
Phil Cahoy, the last performer on the high bar for Nebraska. All they need here is an exercise with no major breaks. Just get through it. And what a way to do it with a class performer like Phil Cahoy. His senior year, he's won 4 NCAA titles, individual titles. The team now going for its 5th. Pahoy looks great. Getting ready for the dismount now. That's it. That's number 5.
Number 5, Nebraska seeking its 5th consecutive NCAA team championship. And with that performance by Phil Pahoy, they've done it. Phil Pahoy, Nebraska, coming up with an outstanding performance with a 9-7 on the horizontal bar. Nebraska with a 287.8 wins their 5th consecutive NCAA championship with an all-time scoring record. UCLA 2nd, Penn State 3rd. We'll be back, but let's go now to Salt Lake City after these words from your local station.
Welcome back to the University of Utah. I'm Charlie Neal along with Kathy Johnson. And in case you just joined us for this 1983 NCAA Women's Gymnastics Championship, the University of Utah has won the team title for an unprecedented 3rd straight time. Now we're ready for the individual championships. Kathy, what can we expect to see? Fill us in.
That's right. We've already seen the girls compete for the individual all around, and those winners have been established. Now we're going to see the top girls in each event compete for the top honors on the 4 events: vault, balance beam, uneven bars, and floor exercise.
And the largest crowd to ever see an NCAA Women's Gymnastics Championship, over 8,000 on hand in Salt Lake City. The individual floor exercise is underway, so let's bring you up to date on some of the other events. In the vault, Elaine Alfano from the University of Utah is the winner. We see her score a 9-6.
Elaine did a handspring front in the piked position. It was one of the most difficult vaults done in this competition. She has tremendous speed. Now watch the rise off the horse. She has beautiful height, and look at the pike. A little bit of trouble with the landing, but with the dynamics and the difficulty of the vault, it scored very high.
A 9-6, and she repeats for the 2nd straight year as the NCAA vault champion. On the bars, Jerry Cameron, who came so close to winning the overall, but she got her championship here from Arizona State with a 9-5.
Jerry has a very fast-moving routine. Here's her major swing, clear hip to handstand. She has 2 release moves. There's 1, and she does a front somersault right here to the high bar. Now she prepares for her dismount. She had a little bit of trouble here. She did the clear hip to handstand, came up short, turned. Now with a quick change of the mat, she'll dismount the other way. Soul circle front, nice high dismount, and good landing.
Jerry Cameron, the bars champion from Arizona State. And Kathy had a chance to talk with Jerry Cameron.
From the history of this competition, it's very unusual for a senior to do so well. And you've done well for 4 years. Why do you feel that's so?
Well, I set my goal as a freshman when I came to ASU to not fall into the college trend of getting worse every year. I set my goal to improve every year, and every nationals I've improved, so I'm excited.
Well, you certainly have done that, and congratulations for winning the bar competition.
And on the beam was Julie Goey from Cal State Fullerton.
Julie did an excellent job in finals. She's always been consistent on beam, but she put it together better than she's ever done it.
The recipient of the 1983 American Award, which goes to the top senior collegiate gymnast in the nation. Now let's go back to the floor exercise, which is underway. Lisa Zeiss from Arizona State is on the floor. Elfie Schlegel from Florida has already competed. And Lisa Zeiss is looking for that championship.
Lisa's very strong on the floor exercise. She's a world-class gymnast, has competed internationally for several years. She's really looking for this championship right here. Last pass, full twist. This is a new routine for Lisa as well. Strong finish. Nice exercise.
Lisa Zeiss from Arizona State. Floor exercise. From Cheektowaga, New York, a freshman at Arizona State. We'll await her score. A 9.5 for Lisa Zeiss. She's the new leader, and we'll be back with more in just a moment. And these are the standings in the individual floor exercises. Zeiss, Cameron, and Schlegel. You're looking at Tanya Rogers from Cal State Fullerton, and she's competing in the floor exercise. She's trying to take over the lead.
Tommy's a very strong tumbler and a good dancer as well.
see a good performance from her.
The fact that she's a dance major, does that help her in this type of routine?
Oh, definitely. You can see it in her choreography. There's a lot of variation, yet it has the same flavor throughout. Nice high fall. Just a handstand pirouette. Preparing for her last tumbling run. All she has to do is finish strong. And a full twist. Good control on the landing. Nice strong ending.
Tanya Rogers from Cal State Fullerton, needing a 9.55 to overtake Lisa Zeiss of Arizona State. For the lead, made her score. A fine performance for that freshman from Cal State Fullerton. Coach Lynn Rogers. Let's see what score she comes up with. Meanwhile, Ken Neal is standing there getting ready. Here it is, a 9.5. So she'll be the co-leader with Lisa Zeiss in the floor exercise championship. Now from Arizona State, here's another freshman, Kim Neal.
Now we're going to see yet another style. Kim has a beautiful dance style and a nice selection of music.
She needs a 9.55 to win it.
Kim could very possibly do that. Her double back. Very nice landing.
The two co-leaders looking on intensely. On the left, Lisa Zeiss from Arizona State, her teammate. And on the right, Tanya Rogers from Cal State Fullerton, the co-leaders.
Kim has beautiful extension, and look at the flexibility. She has a lot of dance training.
She was one of the nation's top recruits from Mesa, Arizona.
Oh, nice turn. The choreography is really pretty. Good leaps. Preparing for her last tumbling run. All she needs is a good, strong landing for a nice exercise. Beautiful.
From Arizona State, trying to take over the lead in the floor exercise. She needs a 9.55. Look at part of her routine once again.
This is her first pass. She does a double back. She gets a good takeoff and an excellent landing. Very nice.
As we await the score, there it is, a 9.6, and there is our new winner in the floor exercise, Kim Neal, the freshman from Arizona State. So here are the individual floor exercise final results. Kim Neal of Arizona State finished first. Tanya Rogers and Lisa Zeiss tied for second. And congratulations to our individual champions. You're looking at them now, Alfano, Cameron, Gulley, and Neal. And this young lady, Megan McCunough, from the University of Utah, the 1983 all-around champion. For Kathy Johnson, I'm Charlie Neal, and right after these messages, we'll send you back to Penn State and men's gymnastics.
We're looking now at two of the bright stars in this competition, Scott Johnson and Peter Vidmar, as they sit awaiting to compete on the high bar. But let's take a look at some of the other individual event champions in this competition.
On the floor exercise, from Arizona State University,
Donnie Hinton. Donnie does a very original routine with a lot of springy motions.
His teammate from Arizona State, Dave Branch, on the floor exercises. Nine for Dave Branch. Branch, Hinton, and Scott Johnson all scoring 9-9. Doug Kiso on the pommel horse, Northern Illinois.
Doug Kiso did a near-perfect routine, scoring a 9.95 to edge out Tom Lapman from Penn State.
Doug Kiso and a 9.95.
On the rings, it was Alex Schwartz from UCLA. 2 years ago, Alex was third in the championship, last year second, and this year, he finally won it.
On the vaulting track, Chris Regal, the freshman from Nebraska, seeking his first national collegiate individual title. Nine for Chris Regal.
And tying Regal on the vault from Oklahoma, Mark Oates. Another 9.9.
Scott Johnson won the parallel bar with a 9.85. And here he is, getting ready now on the high bar.
What a tremendous time Scott's had this year competing. He came in, one floor exercise, one parallel bar. He's going after his third of the competition individual title on the high bar. Led his team to the fifth consecutive title. Now watch this move right there. Nice release skill, right on the money. Still has one more triple flyaway left. There it is. What another super exercise by Scott Johnson.
Is he red hot or not? What a meet he's had. Scott Johnson putting it all together.
And here's that release move from one arm, a delta of perfect. And now the triple flyaway. One, two, three.
Outstanding. Outstanding. Scott Johnson earns a score of 9.95 on the horizontal bar. The next competitor is Peter Vidmar from UCLA on the high bar.
Boy, it must feel good to Scotty to almost have won three. He got a 9.95 in that routine. The only thing in his way is this man, Pete Vidmar. Pete is certainly capable of another 9-9 or even a 10 on this event. This is one of his strongest pieces. Watch this now, a double release move. There's one, there's two, super. And you think he's done? He's not. Here's another release move. Winding up for the dismount, a double layout salto. Hop took a couple steps backward. That could have cost him.
Peter Vidmar had everything going for him. Took a little false step there on the dismount, but had an outstanding exercise on the horizontal bar. There it is, 9-9 for Peter Vidmar.
So Scott Johnson wins his third title of the competition by taking the high bar.
Peter, your overall reaction to this 41st Men's Gymnastics Championship?
An amazing event, Irv. You know, Nebraska did it. They took the fifth consecutive title. Peter Vidmar in the all-arounds showed that he is number one in collegiate men's gymnastics today. We saw so many 9.9s and 9.95s. USA Men's Gymnastics is just skyrocketing.
We'd like to extend our congratulations to Nebraska for winning a fifth consecutive title and Peter Vidmar for repeating as the all-around champion in all the individual event champions for 1983. So this is Irv Cross for Peter Corman saying goodbye from Penn State.
Gymnastics champion.